So I've got a little something different planned for Christmas Eve with my comments for you tonight. Because truthfully, this is the weirdest year I have lived through in my entire 50 years on this planet. It's the strangest year I've ever seen. And I thought, well, I'm going to do something a little different tonight because it's a different kind of year. So I was reading the story about a husband and wife that went shopping in the mall to do some last-minute Christmas shopping, and she walked by a shoe store, and she said, just a minute, dear, I just want to browse. And an hour later, she turned around, and her husband was gone, and she didn't know where he was, and so she called him on his cell phone and said, where are you? And he said, well, you remember that jewelry store in the mall that we went to about 10 years ago? Remember the one that had that diamond necklace that you just loved, and I told you at the time it was too expensive for me to buy now, but someday, when we can afford it, someday. Remember that story? And she goes, yeah, I remember that store. And he said, well, I'm at the pretzel shop right next door to it, so come on down and find me. And not exactly what she was hoping for. And that kind of sums up 2020 in one sentence. Not exactly what we were hoping for. I set goals every year. None of my goals anticipated COVID and everything that was going to take place in this year. And you think about all the losses that we experienced as a nation. I mean, how many things could I put on a slide like this with the sicknesses and the job losses and family stress? And because of that, because everyone trapped at home, more divorces and higher rates of alcoholism and businesses closing and evictions and kids and schools being so affected in so many ways. I mean, we could talk about that last one a lot. They have really, really suffered because of what they have had to experience in this year, in a year unlike anything that I've ever seen in our country's history. And so a lot of people, truthfully, are hurting as we enter into the Christmas season. There were plenty of people at work who were not going to be able to be with their families this holiday season. And so traditions that have been long-standing, their entire lives were not going to even be able to happen this year. And so there's a lot of people hurting. Here's what I've learned over the years, and what I've seen in myself, what I know from others as well, is when people start to be in pain, and the pain just keeps going on and on and on and on, and it has no ending, then what people need in the middle of that is hope. And I believe that this is a great time to talk about hope. It's Christmas. I think that there are some things that we can talk about tonight that can tie into Christmas that can really be important for us, no matter what 2021 brings. So I just real briefly want to share a couple of reasons why you can have hope at this time and going forward. There's nothing to fill in. You have notes, but I'm not even going to go through all this stuff on here tonight. I just want to highlight a couple of things. First, the first thing I want to say to you tonight is I really want you to remember that there are still two tracks in your life. And I've taught on this before, but it is one of the most important foundational things you can lay in your life is this internal understanding that this is wrong. Because this is how we tend to view life. This is wrong. We talk about life in terms of hills and valleys. We talk about life in terms of, oh, you know, things are going good. Hey, we're at the hill. We're on the mountaintop. Things are going good. And when things are bad, we're in the valley. And we think of it in terms of these extremes, and that's not reality. You are never only on the mountaintop, and you are never only in the valley. Life is instead two tracks. And you always, every day of your life, have one track on a track where things are going good. And you always have a one wheel on the track where things are not going as good as they could be going. So that's always true for you. And if you think it's hills and valleys, then when things are bad, you will ignore everything good in your life. And that's just not a healthy place to be. Matter of fact, I don't know what your Christmas tradition is going to be like tonight, what you're going to be doing this weekend. I don't know, but if it is appropriate for you with your family, I think it would be helpful. But for sure, individually, at some point in the next few days, I encourage you to sit down and make a little list. And you make your own two tracks. And you answer these questions. What I went through in 2020 that wasn't very good. And don't belabor that one. Because if I asked that right now, if I said, hey, let's just talk about what didn't go good in 2020. Oh my goodness, we could fill the rest of the time. We'd be done, right? Because it's so front of mind for all of us. But if I asked you, tell me what went right in 2020. That's going to be a lot harder for people. And the truth is, in 2020, you had things go good that were worthy of saying thank you, God, for. worthy of being grateful for. And you had things that didn't go so well. You had both. So did I. And if you only think about the negative, it has a toxic effect on you. And I don't want that for you. We know that if you will do this two-track living and you will constantly remind yourself of what you have to be grateful for, then you get hope. Because things aren't always terrible all the time. And you'll be grateful for what you have, which is so powerful for your life, and you'll have the ability to remain positive, and maintaining a positive attitude is so essential for you to be successful in life. And you also get this anticipation that God is still at work. So here's what I did. I like to practice what I preach, and I made my list, and my list is right in front of me. And I sat down and I started with 2020, what did not go so well. And I mean, honestly, there were some extremely painful things, like for every one of us. And I stopped that list after just a few items, because truthfully, I just didn't want to put it in my mind anymore. And then I pivoted. And I made myself think back to 2020 and say, what is it that I have to thank God for from 2020? And then the list started to fill. And to my surprise, as I was going through it, I immediately started feeling different. You know your brain is wired to make you feel better when you're being grateful. Did you know that? God has made it so that you release happy chemicals in your brain when you're grateful. It's why keeping this two-track way of living is the best way to live your life. I was going through my list of things that I'm grateful for, and one of them I put in all caps. I got to see all of my kids this year on the same day. Now that may not sound like a big deal to you, but I have 6 kids, and they live in Omaha, Colorado, Minnesota, Green Bay, just south of Appleton, all over. So, and they're all starting their lives, and some have kids, and they're all grown and gone. So the days of me getting to see all my kids on the same day, that's way in the past. In early November, all my kids were at my house, and for the first time in 4 years, I had all of my kids together. And I can't even begin to tell you the joy I felt leading up to it, and the incredible joy just having them there, and being able to sit and just look at my children grown and just be with them and experience them, and the sadness when the day came when they were leaving. And just the love that I have, and every minute with them, is so valuable to me. And I have a list of things like that from 2020 that I will be so grateful that God let me have. And nobody got COVID. We made it through, and it went great. So you have this, and I want to challenge you at some point in this holiday weekend to stop what you're doing, and if it's appropriate with your family, do it with your family. I don't know how big your get-togethers are going to be tonight, if you're going to be alone, what it is. But it would be interesting to sit down and say, let's just stop and talk about what do we have to be grateful for from 2020. And have that conversation. Because you have two tracks, and that's important. But I say that because I don't want to ignore the pain track, and I want you to see something tonight about that. And that's the only other thing I'm going to talk to you about real briefly is this. And what I want you to know is, especially in the middle of so much uncertainty and so much pain from this year, I want you to know that there's a God who has made promises to you about the pain that you've lived through. This is so important for you to understand. And I want to tell you this in a little different way. Last Sunday, if you want to watch the first part of this, I was talking about the Christmas movie Klaus. Have you ever seen this on Netflix? It is, hands down, one of my all-time favorite Christmas movies. Netflix just released it last year. If you haven't watched it, I highly encourage it. You will see the spiritual lessons in this movie so easily. I taught on it last Sunday, and there was something I couldn't get to, and I told the church I'll talk about it tonight. So that's why I'm speaking about it, but it's really relevant tonight in light of all that we've lived through in the last year. So if you're not familiar with the movie Klaus, it's about this guy, and I won't give away all the plot, but you just need to know this. So it's about Jesper. Jesper is raised in a rich and powerful home. His dad is super wealthy and super powerful, and Jesper never works a day in his life. All he does is lounge around on his silk sheets and eats caviar and has his servants doing whatever he wants. Well, his dad doesn't really like that, so his dad tries to get him a job as a postmaster. And so he sends him off to postmaster school, and he fails it on purpose. every test he fails on purpose, because he is not going to get a job. And his goal is that he's so bad at this that they send him home, and his dad says, well, you gave it a good college try, so come on back to your silk sheets and caviar and your nice spoiled life. And so that's what Jesper anticipates happening, and that's not what happens. When he goes back to see his dad isn't very happy with him, and he says, congratulations, I'm making you a postmaster, and I'm sending you to the community of Smirensburg, which is this little remote island at the northern part of his kingdom. It's a little tiny fishing village way, way up in the north. And he says, and here's what the reality now, son. Because you blew this off, here's my new reality for you. You have 1 year. In 1 year, if you don't get 6,000 letters stamped by your hand through that post office, I'm cutting you off. And you will never get another dollar from me. It's amazing how a message like that tends to motivate young men. And so Jesper was now highly motivated to get 6,000 letters any way he could. The problem was he finally gets way up into Smirensburg, and it is this dilapidated, rundown community that is in the middle of a civil war between two families that's been going on for generations. The Crumbs and the Ellenbows hate each other and fight all the time. And they can't get along in anything. And when he gets to the post office, the mailroom is full of chickens. There are no letters, none, no letters being mailed. Because these families hate each other, they're not writing anybody, and he has to find some way to motivate the whole town to start sending letters, because he's got 1 year to get 6,000 letters out of here, or he has no future. So he goes to every single house in the village, talks to every single person trying to talk him into sending a letter, and of course nobody wants to send letters, they're fighting with each other, they don't care. And finally, the last house is the house of a woodcutter who lives way up in the corner of this island, this giant of a man. His name is Klaus, and he goes to visit Klaus to try and talk him into sending letters. And he goes into Klaus's house, and he is stunned to see toys. This giant of a man who lives all alone in the middle of nowhere, his whole house is full of toys, beautifully decorated, handmade toys by this woodcutter who lives alone. Doesn't quite make sense. But eventually friendship strikes up between Klaus and Jesper, and Jesper comes upon a great idea. He convinces the kids of the village that if they will send a letter to Klaus, Klaus will bring them a toy. And so he starts showing all the kids how to send letters, and the kids buy into this. It's like, letters equal toy, we will write letters. And so they all start writing letters, and the total gets closer and closer to 6,000. And then he teaches the kids, oh, by the way, Klaus will only bring you toys if you're going to be good. And so all of a sudden, all the kids were like, I got to be good too, not just send a letter. And so all of a sudden, they start doing kindness to everybody. Instead of stealing things from their neighbor, they actually bring things to their neighbor. Instead of, you know, laughing or hurting their neighbor, they start caring for their neighbor. And then all of a sudden, their neighbors start returning that kindness. And the whole community starts to change, because kindness changes people. And, this unsolicited amount of kindness given just changes people. And in the movie, you see it. And it is the main thing that I talked about Sunday. If you missed that, you can go watch it. It is so true in our world. Kindness changes people. It's the force that God uses most to change the people in this world. It will never be your anger. It will never be your Facebook posts that are sent out in anger. Never, never, never. But your kindness. Your kindness is what people can't resist. It's the force that God uses to change this world. And his community starts to change. But there's still one question that's left unanswered till later in the movie, and it's, why in the world does this giant woodcutter who lives all the way out in the middle of nowhere by himself have a house full of toys? Why does he have all these toys? And then they later in the movie explain that he wasn't always alone. He'd been married. And he and his wife had dreamed of having their own family, and they wanted lots and lots of kids, and so every day he would build new toys for all the children that they were going to have together. And year after year went by, and he built toys and toys and toys for all of his future kids, and they never were able to have a child, and then she got sick. And she passed away. And his house was full of toys that were never played with. When I was watching this, and again, one of the things that when I teach on a movie, I like to teach on a movie because I want to help people think biblically about what they're watching. And there was immediately some parallels between what was happening in the movie and what happens in real life. And it's really important in light of all the pain that people have lived through in the last year. All the good that comes out of that village, and if you watch the movie, you will see, and it is so beautiful. It is such a beautiful movie to watch. All the good is rooted in that one man's pain. Now, here's why that's significant. If I were to ask you, tell me what hurt you most in 2020. We tend to get hurt from one of three sources, right? For some of you, the very first thing that would come to mind from the pain that you've suffered in this last year is because of what somebody said or did to you. It hurt you so bad that you are still in pain, and maybe it happened a long time ago. You were so hurt by what they said or did, or what they didn't do. Second source of our pain is our poor choices. Isn't that honest? I mean, we're not going to blame everybody else for all the pain in our life. You ever made a bad choice that cost you something? Ever make a bad financial decision, right? A lot of people in pain today because bad financial decisions. A lot of people in pain today because of bad career decisions, right? A lot of people in pain today because of bad relationship decisions. I mean, a lot of the pain that I've brought in my life, or that I've experienced in my life, I brought into my life. I am not just a victim of what others have done, I'm also the perpetrator. I've also been the one to make choices that have hurt me terribly. And then, isn't it true, there's also just pain from this broken world. You don't point at somebody else, it just is there because of this flawed, messed up world that we live in. So you have pain from 2020, maybe in all three of these categories. And here's what God wants you to know. Because of Emmanuel, what we celebrate at Christmas, Jesus means God with us. Because he is with us, he has made promises to us. And his promises are these. Jesus has promised this, I will comfort you no matter what you go through. I will restore your soul when it is broken. And then I will transform that pain in your life into something good. So let me show you what that means. Look at this verse. Paul said this, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus, the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. So I love the description of God in that first part. It says, look at the last two words. He is the God of all comfort. Even today, matter of fact, I was texting before this service, because one of my daughters, it's her first Christmas away. First Christmas living in another state, not with me, and it's a tough transition. And she's having a hard night. And it's going to be the first time, you know, that she's not here on Christmas Eve, and then not waking up, and Dad's got presents under the tree for her, and it's a big change. And she's hurting tonight. And because I love her, all I want to do is comfort her. Right? Isn't that what you want as a parent? When your kids are in pain, you want to comfort them. God is the perfect parent. Every pain you've experienced in 2020, his great desire is to comfort you, like you would want to comfort any of your kids in pain. So that's the first thing he promises you. I want to comfort you. Then he also promises to restore our soul. Do you know Psalm 23? If you go to a funeral, it's almost always read at every single funeral, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. But what we don't realize is in verse 3, one of the things it says that God does is restores our broken souls. Some of you, well, you feel like your soul has been broken by what you've experienced. The pain is just too, there's a point at which the pain is too overwhelming, and then it feels like you've broken. And Jesus says, I will comfort you, I will restore your souls, and then my favorite promise of all in the New Testament, or throughout the Bible, is the promise that God has made that no matter what you live through, because he so loves you so much, he promises to bring good out of anything you go through, even the pain that you bring on yourself. You want to see an incredible story of this, read the very first book of your Bible. It's the book called Genesis. And there's a story in there about a guy named Joseph. And some of you are going to have family celebrations maybe tonight, and you think that your family is a little dysfunctional. Okay, you may not say anything, but you're like, oh, they're a little dysfunctional. Yeah, This family is dysfunctional. His brothers so hated him, they wanted to kill him. But at the last minute, they decided just to sell him off as a slave. Okay? So you think your family's a mess. They had to be talked out of murdering their own brother. So they sell him off as a slave, and his life just goes from one bad thing to another bad thing to another bad thing. He winds up in jail for a crime he didn't even commit, and he's forgotten by everybody, and it feels like the world has turned his back. But here's the thing, no matter what you have gone through in 2020, no matter what you go through in 2021, God has never stepped away from you. Emmanuel means God with us. He is with you, even in the worst moments of your life. And he promises to bring good out of anything you're going through. And you see it in the life of Joseph. In a prison cell, God begins to fulfill his promise to Joseph to bring good out of all of this betrayal. And God allows him to speak in front of the Pharaoh, and the Pharaoh elevates him to the second most powerful position in all of Egypt. And later, Joseph sees his brothers, and he says this to them, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." I want you to know that. There have been people who intended to hurt you in 2020. They intended to hurt you. It wasn't an accident. And some of you, it wasn't the last year, it's been years and years. And you are in pain because of that. It hurts. And yet, God has made this promise to you. Even in those situations where you're in pain because they wanted to hurt you, our God is so committed to you that he promises to bring good out of anything you go through. I will comfort you, I will restore your soul, and then I will transform that pain and bring good from it. Now, that just sounds like pastor speak, right? That's what pastors say. They say these kind of things. God just does good. He brings good out of your pain. And there's a reason why I'm telling you this tonight. The woman on the right is Kay Warren. Her husband next to her is Rick Warren. Pastor's one of the largest churches in the country. He wrote a book years ago called The Purpose-Driven Life. Matter of fact, on the back table, we have little booklets of his called The Purpose-Driven Life. It's just a little piece of it. If you're only going to read one book in 2021, read this book, The Purpose-Driven Life. It will change your life. So good. So Rick Warren and Kay, they've pastored this, certainly one of the top five largest churches in our country. And in 2003, she was reading a magazine article, and this is how God works. Just picked up a magazine one day, flipping through it, and she read an article. Do you know that in Africa today, there are 12 million orphans? 12 million, because their mom and dad both are dead because of AIDS. The number is just a ridiculous number to think about. 12 million kids with no mom or dad because they're dead because of AIDS. And she read this and her heart was broken, and she started talking to her husband, "Can we do something as a church?" And so she started talking. He's like, "Yeah, let's talk about this and what can we do as a church to try and make a difference around the globe with this epidemic of AIDS." And so they were getting close to having a public announcement and making their first big speech in the church and talking about galvanizing the church to see what they could do to make a difference. And she had a routine checkup at the doctor, and she was with the radiologist getting an exam, and the radiologist walked over to his assistant and said in a voice way too loud, because Kay heard it, he said, "It looks like cancer." And then he walked out of the room. Kay said, "I wanted to scream. I wanted to thrash my limbs and run from the room. And all that kept me quiet was this fragment of a verse from the book of Job that floated into my mind that says, 'He knows the way I take.'" She said she got up and walked over to the door. Her assistant was waiting in the lobby for her, and she told her, "I have to go home. The doctor thinks I have cancer." And then she said, "I leaned against the wall and I sobbed." She was so heartbroken. She finally feels like she's found her calling in life, making a difference in a worldwide issue. And weeks before they're to launch this, she's diagnosed with breast cancer. She said, "I tried reasoning with God. I said, 'I don't want this road, please. I want the life I had just a few days ago. It's all clear, Lord. I'm here to help people with AIDS, and I'm getting ready to do that, kids, adults. So why this, why now? Have you ever asked those two questions? Ever said to God, why this and why now? She said her whole life changed. Life became a series of trips to the doctor and surgery and chemotherapy and nausea and exhaustion and all of her hair falling out. She said, my kids stayed at the house with me. Rick cut back on his teaching schedule so he could go with me to every appointment. I realized, surrounded by love. Just having someone near when you're sick, what a blessing. She said, I was one of the lucky ones. The doctor said my treatment was successful and her cancer went into remission. But that wasn't the end. She really began to develop a passion for helping people with AIDS in Orange County, where their church was. She didn't just want to help people who were the children who were dying overseas. So she began to, sorry, I got my notes out of order. There we go. So she began to, she discovered in Orange County, California, every year, 3,300 people die of AIDS. Not a big number. 3,300 people a year, right where her church was, were dying of AIDS. So she reached out to a man named Bill who was the director of called the Orange County AIDS Outreach Organization. She set up a meeting with him. Bill came to meet with her, and truthfully, he was super skeptical. Christians at a church want to help people dying of AIDS in California? Yeah, he had zero interest in this meeting. Kay met with him, and no matter what she said, she couldn't convince him that their church was just well-meaning and sincere. They just wanted to help. Because he could not be convinced that Christians didn't want to get with his people and give them sermons and preach to them and all the things Christians tend to do. Condemn them, tell them they're going to hell and all of that stuff. And so at one point he was done. He pushed back from the table. He was about to leave. And Kay said, listen, I understand your concerns. But before you go, I want to explain the reason I invited you here. She said, I don't know what it's like to have AIDS, but I do know what it's like to have a life-threatening illness. Last year, I had breast cancer. I went through surgery and chemotherapy, and it was awful. But during those months, what mattered most was having people around me, just holding me, just knowing they were there, I wasn't afraid to die. She said, Bill looked at me startled. He reached out and put his hand on mine, and he said, I'm not afraid to die either. But there is something I am afraid of. Dying alone. Kay said, Bill, I make you a promise. All we at Saddleback want to do, the name of their church, Saddleback Church, want to do is bring the love of God to sick people to make sure that no one has to die alone. She said, the room grew still. And Bill said, well, maybe we can work with you. She said, today, volunteers all across the church are working directly with AIDS patients in Orange County, driving them to doctor's appointments, inviting them over to dinner, doing life together, and making sure no one dies alone. And here's why I'm telling you this story. When I read this, I was just blown away. She said, I don't believe God wanted me to get cancer. But once I had it, I believe he used it to change me. To teach me in a way that I had never known what Jesus meant when he told his disciples, love one another. The meaning is really quite simple. Open your heart and be present and give care. That's the kind of love I received, and it's the kind of love I long to give. So Kate Warren knows exactly what it means for Emmanuel, God with us, to make these promises to her, to say, I will comfort you and restore you, and then I will actually transform the pain that you live through, and I will bring good out of something awful that you've just experienced. How many of you could ever think God could do that with breast cancer? And that's our God. He is more in love with you than you've ever imagined. He loves everything about you. Any moment you give him is the greatest moment for him. Because you matter so much to him. And when you look at those three concepts up there, maybe one of those really resonates with you tonight. For some of you, you really need his comfort. because you are really hurting tonight. And life has not gone the way you'd hoped it would go this year in 2020. Let me just tell you this. He comforts you in relationship with Him. He is a real and personal God. And if you will turn to Him, and the key words I've found so many times, the key words are saying to God, God, you know what? I need you. Those are power words with God. To say to Him, I need you. And tell Him that you need Him to comfort you. And then when you want to listen for God, there are free Bibles on the back too. You can take one on your way out. Flip right to the middle. The biggest book in the middle is called the Book of Psalms, and just read. I don't even know how many times in my life I've read in that book when I was in pain and God comforted me from His word. You can find comfort. He will speak to you if you will listen for Him. Some of you need that restoration because your soul feels broken and it just doesn't feel like it used to feel. And in relationship with Him, He restores your soul. And some of you need meaning and purpose because the pain that you've lived through seems so meaningless and random. And with this God of love, no meaning, God never wastes a painful experience, ever. He didn't bring them, but He is so committed to you that He will bring good out of that painful experience. Now, maybe you're here or watching tonight and you're just exploring your faith with us because it's Christmas and maybe this is what you do, but I want you to know the proof of how much He loves you is forever demonstrated in what He did on this night 2,000 years ago. He came so He could get closer to us. Here's the reality. I would give almost anything just to be with my kids. I absolutely love every minute I get with them. And every time I'm with them and I have to leave or they have to leave, I'm sad. And I am a flawed dad. God is a perfect Father. And He loves you with a love way beyond the love that I have for my children. There is no moment of your life that He isn't thinking about you and wanting to be closer to you. And Jesus made that relationship possible. The Bible says that our God, our Father, is a perfect being, pure love. And to be with Him, we have to be loving. I mean, isn't that crazy? I mean, we have to be perfectly loving. None of us are. It's why Jesus came. He said He came to give His life as a ransom for us. He had to pay the ultimate price on the cross to pay for the things we've done that were wrong in this world so that we could be forgiven. If you let Him, He will forgive you and He will enter into a relationship with you. Let me have you bow your heads. Maybe this is the next step for you spiritually. He loves you more than you've ever imagined. More than I could ever describe. If I was the most articulate man who's ever lived and could write volumes about the love of God, I would never come close to actually covering the subject. He thinks about you every moment of every day. You are His treasure and He wants to be in relationship with you and His Son makes that possible. And if you want Him, you just have to turn to Him. You just have to say something in faith like this to Him. Just say, Jesus, I'm turning to You tonight. I need You. I've certainly done and said unloving things in my lifetime. I know I've hurt others. But Jesus, I heard You came into this world to give Your life for me. Please forgive me. I want a new relationship with You tonight. I pray that You'd give that to me. In Jesus' name, amen.